I'm going to talk to you, tell you a story of Cindy. Cindy is a sweet little girl, and she was once praying with her mother, and when they started praying, Cindy said, "Mama, I want to thank God today because I got the nicest and the cutest fairy dress and the lovely shoes." God, Rachel is smiling because she must be having one pair of lovely shoes with her, right? And so she was very excited. "Mama, I want to thank God for this." And as they read the word, they read Galatians chapter 10 verse 6. Can somebody read it for me, please? What is that verse? It says, "Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." Amen. I'm reading from NIV. "As we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." And Cindy was excited in her heart. When she prayed and thanked God, she understood that there is something that she is forgetting. She immediately changed, brushed her teeth, and she went off to the bed. As she was under the cover, Cindy started realizing that they remembered her friend, Rahel, was not having the shoes. So she went to her mother and she said, "Mama, I want to pray for Rahel also because Rahel is not having good pair of shoes. She's been using all summer this very pair of shoes and her shoes." Now when Cindy came back to her bed, she was undercover and she was thinking, "Now everything is done, I'm okay." But still something was going on in her mind. Why am I not at peace? Why am I unable to sleep? And then suddenly, she threw the cover off. She ran to her mother. She said, "Mama, I got the answer of my prayers." "What was the prayer that you prayed?" She said, "I prayed for Rahel, and now I know what is the answer of my prayer. I am the answer of my prayer." Mama said, "What?" "Mama, you know, I've been saving money from my pocket money for Christmas. I'm not going to use it to buy another pair of shoes for me. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to use that money to buy a pair of shoes for Rahel. I am the answer of my prayer." And this morning, church, I am going to lead you with this one theme. Would you like to be an answer of someone's prayer? Would you like to be an answer of someone's prayer? We all pray. We all pour out our heart to God, saying that, "God, please help those people. Please heal them." Can I be an answer to someone's prayer this morning? So please, church, join me in prayer as we begin the meditation of His Word this morning. Father God, we want to thank You that You are an almighty God. There is no one like You, O Lord. We want to thank You for this opportunity that we can open Your Word, read it, and meditate upon it. Lord, we pray as we share from the Word, Lord, we pray that You will bless us. That, Lord, You will speak to us. That, Lord, You will enlighten us, Lord. Thank You so much for this opportunity. Once again, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Okay, so are we willing to be an answer? This is going to be the theme this morning. And the key verse that we are going to look at is Matthew chapter 5 verse 44. Can we open and read? Can we open our Bibles? Matthew chapter 5 verse 44 onwards. Maybe 43 onwards we can read. Jesus is teaching about loving enemies. "You have heard that it was said, 'Love your neighbors and hate your enemy.' But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. He causes His sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. And the key verse that I'm going to focus on from this particular passage is, but I tell you, Jesus is saying this, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for them. Can we read this verse in multiple language? Matthew chapter 5 verse 44. Matthai 5 adhyay 44 pad. Anybody's got Telugu Bible, Kannada Bible, Marathi Bible, English Bible, Hindi Bible? Can we read it in multiple languages? Got Marathi Bible, Aldrin, by any chance? Sam? 44th vachan, padhiye. अपने बैरियों से प्रेम रखो और अपने सताने वालों के लिए प्रार्थना करो. सताने वाले हमेशा हमारे दिमाग में रहते हैं क्योंकि वो सताते रहते हैं. But Bible is saying that you should pray for those who are persecuting you. Any other language that we have? Auntie, you have a different language? Please read it loud. Amen. पांचवा अध्याय मत्ते कृत शुभर्धमान पांचवा अध्याय आणि चौरेचाळीसावं वचन. Any other language? Telugu. Yes, those who are persecuting you, pray for those. Telugu mein kaha dvesh karne walon se, those who hate you, those who persecute you, pray for them. Marathi. Tumcha je vait karta tyancha sathi prarthna kara, means those who do unwell to you, pray for them. Amen. You know what this tells us? These all smiling faces this morning gives us a picture of heaven. Heaven is a place where people will come from ends of earth, people who are talking about different languages, praising the one who is sitting on the throne. Amen? Any other language we have? Malayalam, auntie, read. Amen. Praise God. Awesome. It's a privilege to be in this family. Right? Praise God for that. So, are we ready to pray for those who persecute us? Have you gone through persecution? I think none of us has gone through persecution, right? And opposition is something that we face every time. But persecution is something. I wanted to request Milton to share with us about the persecution. But I don't want to take him on the as a surprise. But if he's willing, as the service goes by, we'll ask him to share one experience which he shared with me last week about Pastor Chandrakant. I would like him to be prepared. I'm going to ask him once during the service to tell us about that one episode when Pastor Chandrakant went through the persecution. Let's go ahead and understand what I'm going to share this morning. We are going to again look at Acts chapter 9. Can somebody tell me what is Acts chapter 9 about? Saul. How was Saul? Saul was a nice man? Hey, who said no? Saul was not a nice man. Rachel? Saul was a nice man? Initially, he wasn't a nice man. Was it true? He did what he was thinking right. Was it right according to the law that time? Yes. Was he authorized to do what he was doing? Who was authorizing him? The Pharisees were authorizing him. The leaders of the church were authorizing him. The teachers of the law authorized him to do what he was doing. So we are going to talk about a little bit about Paul, but Paul is not the theme of this morning session. So we are going to go into introduction. Acts chapter 7, 58 verse says, meanwhile, the witness laid their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. Why did they leave their clothes? Because all of them were excited, thrilled about going to stone Stephen. We got him. Now we are going to kill him by stoning. So they opened their outer clothes, kept it with Saul. Saul was standing there saying, okay, go. and ensure that you are going to kill this man of God. Saul was standing there witnessing the death of our very own Stephen. Next. Acts 7:60b. Second verse says, and Saul was there giving approval to his death. Stephen's death. Who approved it? He was the officer who was supposed to execute this very task to take Stephen out and kill him, stone him to the death. This was Saul. Somebody said he was a nice man. Somebody said he was not a nice man. How many of you would like to love your enemy like Saul, who has killed our brother? Hit you? Would you like to love somebody who has hit your brother? No. Why? I know. For him it is difficult. We all are laughing. Think about your own self. Would you love a person who has molested your sister, troubled your father, hit your brother? Would you love that person? Next, please. Acts chapter 9 verse 1. The ninth chapter starts with this very, very strong verse. It says, meanwhile, Saul was breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciple. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, that is Jesus Christ, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. Have you seen any victory parade of police? When the police arrest the goons or the murderers, or have you witnessed? I was in Thane a couple of years back, maybe 97, 95 types. That time, Shiv Sena was full in form, and people were like Hindu-Muslim, that riot was towards the end of it. But still Thane was the stronghold of Shiv Sena, and so people used to go in open jeeps with open swords, open weapons in their hand, and to see whether there is anybody who is not following the new diktat. Then new commissioner came in Mumbai. I think Chandrasekhar was the new commissioner, and he started raiding all the goons. And I was there to see one of the parades. How did they do, you know? They tied all the goons behind a jeep, you know. All of them were walking like this, and the police commissioner and his team was going in front. And they wanted to show to the city that we caught them. Don't try to do this with us again. You will be treated worse than them. Saul came to the church high priest saying that you give me the authority, I will go to the places and I'll pick up the people and I'll bring them back to the prison in Jerusalem. Love your enemies. I'm not saying this. Jesus has said that. Love your enemies. The next one. Okay. So this very Saul in the same chapter, when he was going towards Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? Saul asked. I am Jesus who you are persecuting. Was he persecuting Jesus Christ? His people. But when the Lord responded to Saul, Lord said, I am Jesus. If you touch one of my dear ones, you are touching the apple of my eye. I am that Jesus Christ. And you are touching the very apple of my eye. And then says, who are you, Lord? I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. He replied, now get up and go into the city and you will be told what you must do. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but they did not see anyone. Saul got up from ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could not see anything. Saul was blind. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could not see anything. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. He was going to Damascus. He was going maybe on his horse as a leader. And there he has an encounter with Jesus Christ. He fell down from the ground. And when he tried to open his eyes, he could not see. The same Saul was again taken to the same city where he was heading, but being led by someone else. I do not know. None of us have the experience of becoming blind. Is there anybody who has received sight recently? No? Sam? No? We are all born intelligent people with sight. But try and talk to those who can't see. They just feel an experience. Okay? Saul, who could see, now he can't see. Next one, when we look at, he was blind and he was helpless. He was fasting and seeking. This is not me telling, but the Bible tells us. What the Bible is saying, in the 9th verse he says, for 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. He was fasting. He was praying. Why do I say that he was praying? Because later in the same verse, we come to understand that when God speaks to Ananias, he says that, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In the 9th verse of 9th chapter, right? 9th verse of 9th chapter, it says, 11th verse of the 9th chapter, it says, he is praying. For 3 days, 3 nights, he was blind. God closed his eyes to see what he wants him to see. Right? Now the same Saul has been led to somebody who was helping him. And Saul was praying, seeking God's face. Then go and bless him. Acts chapter 9. God is talking to Ananias. I want to ask you something. Saul was heading towards Damascus. He was going to? What for he was going for? To catch people as? Karan? As prisoners, right? Who were those people? Any name you know? One name I want. At least one person you should know. Ananias. One person he was going definitely for was Ananias. Why Ananias, I'm saying? 10th verse it says, in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. He was staying in Damascus. Saul was going with his all army, mighty army, to catch this, at least this one person. I'm definitely sure that he was going to catch Ananias. And God is talking to whom? Ananias again. Ananias must be very happy to hear God's voice when God calls him. Ananias, who is this? God, speak to me. What is it that you want me to do? You want me to go on mountain and lead your people? God says, the Lord told him, he said, 11th verse, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street. Address is given. The house is given. And ask for a man, Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore his sight. Now, Ananias received a phone call from God saying that you have to go. Okay? You have to go because somebody is expecting you. Name was given to him. Time was given to him. The action this person is going to do is going given to him. Now you have to go. Ananias must be very happy, right? Would you be happy, Kanishka? If you are asked to go to pray for Saul, who has killed your brother, Stephen, he witnessed it. He ensured that his blood has been spilled. He ensured that he has been killed.
Will you be interested to go and pray?
Sandesh? What's your take?
You don't know? You won't go.
Right? In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hands on him to restore.
Rise up, Ananias, and go. I am giving you a task. What is the task? Go to your enemy, love him, pray for him, and restore his sight.
In other words, in today's scenario, go to the jail, sell off your property, go to the jail, do a bail for someone who has killed your father. In today's scenario, someone who has killed your brother or father, take all that you have, sell it off, take the money, bail him out. Am I talking sense, church? This is what God has called Ananias to do. Is it a simple task? No. Next one. The reasoning is word versus the world. Yes, it is impossible for me to do this, but this is a word of God. You know, I am reminded of the very story the children like. The story of Jonah. What was asked? Jonah was asked to go to Tarshish. Is it? Nineveh, huh? Okay. Kichu is saying that he is to go to Nineveh. I'm sorry. So he was asked to go to Nineveh and he was happily going to Nineveh, right? No. Why? The people of Nineveh were very cruel to the God's people, and that's why Jonah, being a prophet, said, God, nothing doing, even if this is your command, I don't want to go there. I want to go and run away to Tarshish. Second person who did that? Who ran away from God? Think about it. I am giving you my son Jesus Christ to die for you. And yet me as Amit Wingate running away from God. I am interested in Tarshish. I am not interested in Nineveh. Second person. Jesus Christ died for me. Left his heavenly realm. Came on the ground, on earth to die for me. He gave his life. He rose again. He made a hope for me. He opened the gate for me. And now instead of running towards heaven, I am running towards. Am I different than Jonah? But Ananias didn't do what Jonah did. And that's why the experience of the belly through the belly of whale did not happen with him. What did he do? He first put forward to God, Lord, I think you forgot what he did. Let me remind you. He is an enemy, God. How can you say this? He is an enemy. He killed my brothers. He persecuted the church. He is on one mission to destroy the way. God, please, if you have forgotten, let me remind you. Sometimes it happens, right? Sometimes it happens when we pray, we try to give a reminder to God. Hey God, I think you forgot, you know what? I'm having exams next week and you are asking me to go for jam. Please, let me study so that I should not be. And if I fail, God, I will consider that it is you who failed. Because I have not studied through the week. Only on Saturday I was supposed to study, and jam you have kept on Saturday only. Reminding God. He's trying to remind God. Ananias is trying to remind God. Next one. God is not only our enemy. Being in Damascus, he is the biggest threat to your people. Isn't it? Did you know that after opening his eyes, after getting his sight back, what Saul was going to do? What was the guarantee that when Ananias put his hand on him and prays and he receives and opens his eyes and says, yes, you are the first one. Catch him. Nobody knew that. किसी को पता नहीं था कि
सॉल आंख खुलने के बाद क्या करेगा? नहीं, इट वॉज अ सस्पेंस. एंड येट गॉड इज आस्किंग टू गो, सेइंग दैट यू आर द आंसर ऑफ हिज प्रेयर. You are the answer of his prayer. Ananias, you have to go. Next. What God is saying, he is giving him a reassurance from the heart of God. On the 15th verse, if you read, but the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. There is a purpose why this man is blind and is in Damascus. There is a purpose why each one of you are here in HSR, in Bangalore. There is a purpose for each one of you. Why you are in a particular area in your neighborhood, there is a purpose for you. And the second thing, if you see, God is saying that I'm going to tell him how much he is going to suffer for me. The pain that you are going to go through as a Christian, as a believer. There is a purpose you are here in Bangalore. It's not an accident. Saul was in Damascus led by people as a blind man, had a purpose, and God is saying to Ananias, go, bless him. And the same God is talking to us, saying that people around here, they are singing weeks after weeks, months after months, the prayer of salvation. If you were there last week, Pastor George, he preached, and during his preaching he said, do you know the meaning of Janaganamana? Janaganamana is a prayer from the heart of people of India to the God Almighty for salvation. People are praying around us. We are here not by accident. We are on a mission. There is a purpose why we are here. We may have to go through pain as we serve the purposes of our Almighty God. And the same message is with Ananias, saying that when you go, I must tell you that there is a purpose behind it, and he will have to deal with a great pain as you go through this experience. The next one comes. Ananias doesn't do what Jonah did. He did not book his ticket to Jerusalem. He booked his tickets. He did not book. He went to the straight street. He entered the house. And the first words of his mouth are, what is there in 15th verse or 17th verse? Brother Saul, hey, come on. He just killed your brother Saul, brother, and now you are calling him brother. Brother Saul. There is a response from Ananias' heart to the call of God. We have brothers and sisters around here. Children, you have people with you every week coming to children's club. They are your purpose that God has brought them in your life. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it, and he said, brother, first obedience, second acceptance. Calling him brother is saying that you are part of us now. You are no more an alien to us. You are no more a third party to us. You are a part of our family. There is an acceptance, saying that brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here has sent me. I come with authority. You came with one authority. I am coming with another authority to call you into our family. I am accepting you, brother Saul. Come into our family. And then has sent me to so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. There is healing aspect that comes to him. Says 9:18 says, immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eye and he could see again. He put his hands and he blessed him. Right? Was there any extraordinary thing that God is asking him to do? Go to State Street, find out a person from Tarsus, his name is Saul. He is in some house. Go find out, go and place your hands upon him. I'm going to do wonders through you. Healing came. What we've been praying since 1st January. How many people we have reached out and blessed? Have we touched somebody and said, God bless you? Have we hugged somebody and said, God bless you, brother or sister? Next one. It's a new beginning. What does it say? In the 19th verse, in the 18th verse, second part of the 18th verse says, he got up and he was baptized. Here comes a new beginning for the same Saul who was heading towards Damascus to kill the way is a part of the way now. One man's obedience, Ananias' obedience, bring that paradigm change. You are that Ananias. You and me are the answer of prayers to the people of HSR. If we don't, somebody else, God will send. If we don't go now, if we continue to go somewhere else, what will happen? We may have to go through the belly of well, but we will have to land up here in HSR unless we touch the lives of people around here. And for that, the answer is from you. You are the answer of people who are around here. You know what we are going to do this week? We are going to fast and pray here in this place. In different care cells, we are going to pray. What is the objective of that? That God will fill us with Holy Spirit. What happened to Saul should happen to us. I who was enemy of God, now I'm a friend of God. God, please send Ananias and make me a blessing to those who are still in darkness. Can I have a louder amen? Praise God. Next one. Reminder from the very heart. This comes as a reminder to you and me. I do not know if it has challenged you, it has shaken up you a bit, but it has shaken up me this morning. I stand shaken up this morning. Reach out. Is it too difficult for us to reach out? Last Christmas, what we did? When we started going out, we said maybe a week or so, right? Till the day we started going up for carol singing, we were hoping that we may have only 5 confirmations. We were ready with 3 teams, 3 hours every day, and only 5 confirmations. You know what happened at the end? The same God did wonders. He opened the doors of people's house. We could go inside. People were saying, you come. Even on 25th, they wanted us to come, right? We started on 5th or 15th. 5th we started. And we were not finished till 25th. People were still asking. God will ensure that He is opening doors. It's only your willingness to go to the straight street. That's it. You are the answer for people. Next one. Go an extra mile. You might have to go an extra mile. You know, Pastor Alvin, he used to finish his work and come. Suresh used to come from Whitefield. Every day it was an excitement. It was a thrilling. Sister Rohini was saying, no, I don't want to stay back here. I want to go out. I want to meet and see people. That was an amazing, thrilling time. Go an extra mile. We all were ready to go an extra mile that day. Can't we do it now? Are we ready to go for that extra mile? Just you have to come out of your gate and enter into neighbor's house. Knock the door and say, I'm here with the authority that God has given to me. I'm here to heal you. Do you think God will not do wonders through you? Next one. To bless them. Ananias didn't do anything great, right? He didn't say, oh, abracadabra, dubracadabra, nothing he did. He did nothing. He just went. He put his hands on the head and blessed him. Is it very difficult to say, God bless you? Devak, what was your experience? You remember that big hefty man you met? When Devak was about to give his Bible to that man, Devak was thinking, what if he just touches me with his fist. Okay? And that man, instead of putting his fist on his face, hugged Devak. Can you imagine hugging Devak? He hugged Devak and said, "This is the first time in my life that somebody came and told me, 'God bless you.'" Do you think you'll not be able to walk in? I like what Suresh shared, you know. We were sitting, me, Manubhai, Suresh, Pastor Alvin, we were sitting and we were discussing something. Suresh was saying that we have to go to Chennai today afternoon. Tomorrow is the interview for Ziva with the American consulate. So Manubhai was saying, "It's the trouble, yeah. You have to go wait in the queue and, you know, since morning you'll have to wait. So it's a difficult thing." Suresh said, no. They are US citizens. They can walk straight in. Right, Suresh? They have an authority given by US government that they need not have to stand in the queue. I need not have to stand in the queue, wait for my turn to come and say, "God bless you." No. I have been given authority by God Himself. I can straight away enter to the person and say, "God bless you." Is it so difficult to say? Or is it only for Sunday morning service? "God bless you, God bless you, God bless you." You can do it in your workplace. You can do it in your neighborhood. You can tell to your sabji vendor that, "Brother, God bless you. Sister, God bless you." You can tell it to your maid servant, "God bless you." Next one, to accept them. He called him brother. You know, I liked it. The moment I started preparing for this sermon, on my office WhatsApp chat, am I wishing to my colleague? I'm calling him brother. I'm talking to one of my junior staff. I'm calling him brother. Why? Because I found it so exciting to call brother or sister. I am accepting them. God has accepted me. Can you imagine that? A person like me has been accepted by God. Why can't they be accepted by me? And I'm calling the brother. And it's so exciting just to talk to them as brother and sister. Next one, to heal them. Nobody else, my brothers and sisters. Nobody else is the answer of their prayers but you and me. I am the reason. I can be a channel. God is ready to use to heal your neighbor, your friend, who is best friend of yours. I'm going to tell you one story. This was a skit that we did when I was in one of the church youths. There was one bicycle, two friends riding together. They met with an accident. They both go to the pearly gates of heaven. One was accepted inside the heaven. Another was said not to come. And that friend said, "Why? We are friends. We live together. We die together. Come on, you cannot say no to me." That friend said, the gatekeeper on the heaven, he said, "You can't come." "Why? Why I can't come? We did everything together. We opened our tiffins in school together. We shared our tiffin. We sat on the same bench. Even our handwriting is same. We used to call ourselves brothers. Now how can you part away?" "No, he has accepted Christ as his personal savior. You have not." "Oh, where? When did it happen? I didn't know. I was with him all the while." "No, it happened in one of the Sunday's baptism service when he came and gave his life to Christ Jesus. You were not there in the church that Sunday." "Huh? How come? Why didn't you tell me, brother? I was with you every day, every moment. I was staying next to you. I was sitting next to you. You didn't tell me." "No, I'm sorry. I thought you will feel offended. You will feel bad. You will break your friendship. That's why I didn't tell you." "Brother, we are eternally separated now. I am going the other way. You are going into heaven." Do you want this to happen with your friend? The one who sits next to you in office. The one who travels with you in your bus, in your metro. Every day. Do you want it to happen? You run every day to capture that seat with my friend in bus. I don't want to sit anywhere else. Jesse wants to sit only with Ishan. But does Ishan know about Christ? If he is not allowed inside the heaven, what will happen? Think about it. We are there to heal them. Next, are you willing to pray to God? Are you willing to bless to be an answer to somebody's prayer. God did not call anyone. I like this one. This was a very, very lovely revelation to me. God could have easily called Peter or Silas or, initial disciples from Jerusalem. Hey, come over here. Hey, you know what happened to Saul? Please come. You make your journey started now because it's 150 miles away. If you start in the morning, by evening you will reach to Damascus. You have to pray for Saul. Did he call somebody from Jerusalem? He called somebody who was there in Damascus, available. He called Ananias. He is not going to call somebody from heaven. He is not going to send Jesus Christ again. He is going to use you. He is calling you, you and me, saying that please go to this home, straight street, go open the door, go and bless this man. Because this man has a purpose for my kingdom. You have to do it. Next one. God did not ask him to do anything unusual. I already said this. He did not ask him to do abracadabra. He did not ask him to go, ask him to say that you go with your head covered, your beard been combed properly. No, nothing. No dressing, no dress code, no jadu mantar, nothing. You just go, place your hands upon him. Rest is my job. And God is assuring you the same thing. What you did last Christmas, if you want this, that thing to happen this year in all your mission fields, I would like to encourage you, join us in prayers. At least we can do that. Maybe God will use us to reach out to those who are unreached. Do you have one person in your mind right now? One person who has not been reached. Your friend, your colleague, your busmate, your neighbor, your maid, your shopkeeper, anybody? Close your eyes. Think about that one person whom God has sent in your life, thinking that you will be an answer to his prayers. He's been praying. Close your eyes. Pray for that one person, that God, you have brought this one person in my life. I know there is a purpose. I might have to go through the pain temporarily, but eternally this person will be saved. Think about that one person. The good times that you had together, in the same office, in the same bus, in the same bench, in the same cubicle, we sat together. We had all good things being shared, but Jesus Christ. God is asking you to pray for that one person. God is asking you to consider that you are an answer of his prayers. That person is still in darkness. He is wandering. He doesn't know what to see. His eyes are blind. He cannot see what God wants him to show. Will you reach out to him this week? Will you go and bless him this week? Will you reach out to him? Will you go that extra mile to him? Will you go and talk to him, saying that God has sent me with an authority. I want to bless you, brother. I want to bless you, sister. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you, Lord. We want to thank you for you are an amazing God. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much that there is no comparison of your love. That when we were still sinners, you died for us. Oh Lord, a good friend will die for a good friend. But you are such a good friend, oh Lord, that you died for me who was not even your friend, oh Lord. Thank you so much, Lord. Heavenly Father, the only purpose that you have kept me in the land of living is because I need to reach out, become an answer of somebody's prayer, oh Lord. Heavenly Father, I pray unto you that give me that heart, melt my heart, Lord, shape it the way you want me, and help me to reach out to that person. Pray with him through the week, O Lord. And Heavenly Father, as we wait upon you, we want to see that person coming in your glorious kingdom, O Lord, saved forever and ever, Lord. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this opportunity through your word. Lord, as we commit ourselves into your hands, Lord, make us answers of somebody's prayer, O Lord. Help us to reach out to somebody this week, O Lord. And Lord, we pray unto you, O Lord, that as you did wonders through Ananias, you are going to do wonders through us. Thank you for speaking to us this morning. Lord, as we part from this place, as we have fellowship, Lord, we pray that you will be with us through the week. And Lord, now that the love of Father, the very grace of Jesus Christ and communion of Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen.